Obviously, that's a bit of a kind of not everyone's going to be familiar with what an 18 means to people and what actual effects it has. So, fortunately for us, we have Ian Mudway here, who is a lecturer in respiratory toxicology at King's College. Ian works with schools just north of the tunnel in Poplar, and his research has shown some of the impacts of the air pollution on children's lungs. So, I'll hand over to Ian.
Good evening, everyone. Sometimes you get given numbers on maps, it doesn't mean a great deal, and it doesn't convey to you the sense that air pollution in London is extremely bad, okay? So I thought I'd start this talk by making it a bit more tangible by showing you an image. And this is a picture over here. I'm going to actually walk around. This is taken in March of last year. Well, this year actually, this March. So this is one of those periods where it's cold and you get higher concentrations of nitrogen dioxide. And you can see this sort of brown, sort of, almost like a pallor hanging over the whole of the city. Now that is a cloud of nitrogen dioxide. So forget the number, okay? Forget the size of the number, though it is important. You can see it. From a distance, if you're walking down that street, you won't perceive it at all. It's an invisible gas. But from a distance, looking across London, you can actually see it. And that's what we all live in. And I'm not immune to this. I'm not from Greenwich, but I'm from New Cross, so you know, I'm also living in that cloud. But it's actually a little bit worse than that. Because I can show you a picture which was taken earlier in the day. So this is taken in the sort of late afternoon. You can see the ground is sort of rising above Canary Wharf. But this was taken in the morning. So this is now a photograph taken from Woolwich, looking out across the city. And you can actually, I think, very clearly here see just how bad the nitrogen dioxide pollution gets during the cold winter months in London. And this is another thing, and sometimes people forget this. There's this concept that when you emit pollution from vehicles into the air, it just sort of disperses, and there's a lot of air, and so you don't need to worry about it. If you look at this picture, you'll see actually there's this really quite sharp line. And that's because in the winter, the air is quite cold. It's quite stable. And so effectively, on a cold day in London, you have an invisible ceiling on the atmosphere of about 300 metres. And now pause and imagine that all of the fumes from all of the vehicles in London are actually filling up an area of air which actually has an effective ceiling. It's not dissipating out. Later in the day, it begins to as the atmosphere warms up. But that's why in the morning the air pollution gets particularly bad, more so than in the late afternoon. So you can see it, okay? And if you had a number from a NO2 diffusion tube here, they would be black, okay? It would be in that black sort of range. And then I pose some questions. And these are sort of the questions which are often raised when people say air pollution is quite bad, and people know that it's, but you know, you can derail people's thought processes. The first thing is, well, you've got air pollution, but it's not as bad as it used to be. And they will always take you back on some historical journey back to the 1950s, and they'll show you a picture, this is a very famous picture of the 1952 London smog. And clearly during the smog, things were pretty bad. The one which occurred in December 1952 killed 4,500 people in 5 days. So clearly, you know, something had to be done. Interesting parallel, though. I think this is really important. When they discovered the smog, and this was all coming from coal burning, was killing people in 1952, they did not jump up in government and say, we must do something to save the public health. They said, we can't do anything because we're in a period of economic crisis and it will be destructive to industry and the recovery of the country after the war. Okay? The reason we have a Clean Air Act, and this was dealt with, it's not because the government wanted to do it, it was introduced under the radars of a private member's bill. So even back then, when you had an event that was killing 4,500 people, the government always said they can't do anything with it because it will affect economic development in the country. Sound familiar? It's a little bit familiar with the situation today. But that's not what we have because of the climate. But there are lessons we can learn. So if you go back to 1952, you simply ask the question, who died during that week? And what this is looking at is just a few areas within London, and it's looking at the increased, if you like, ratio of people dying, stratified by age. And this is really, really important. Because when you hear about the London smog and how bad air pollution used to be, you're always told that it was the very old, ill, infirmed people who died. And that's certainly true if you're willing to accept that old is over the age of 45. Okay? Because if you look here, you can see almost a twofold, threefold doubling of death rates within those age groups. And here's the other thing you are never told. It's the other side. The death rate also doubled in children under 1 year. So the sensitive populations, the populations who were suffering the most during these air pollution episodes, were the elderly people who were entering, if you like, sort of their retirement years. Okay. And the young. And you know what? That doesn't change. So we were talking about, if we're having an air pollution debate, we are, should be considering those members of our population who are the most vulnerable, and they do include our children. Okay, as I will point out as we go through this slide. Things have changed. So as the smogs in the 1950s were caused by coal burning, we don't really have coal burning in London anymore. I mean, there are some people who burn biomass in a very dirty way, which they shouldn't really do. And most of our pollution comes from traffic. And this is, again, a point where people get a bit confused, because what are we really talking about? Because there are lots of different types of pollution. We have particle, particulate matter, small particles emitted into the air, which are intangible. You won't see them. If you talk about something having particulate matter 10 microns, that's about the size of E. coli, okay? If you're near a road, the particles which come out of an exhaust pipe are about 100 nanometers. That's the size of the influenza virus. So, you know, you've moved from a visible smoke to an invisible killer. It's still there, it's just changed in its nature. But then we have all these other things. We have carbon, we have carbon monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, which we're really spending most of our time talking about today. Black carbon, then we have a whole host of other things. In this toxic brew, we have polyaromatic hydrocarbons, we have VOCs, we have methods. In fact, diesel exhaust contains one of the most carcinogenic compounds which has ever been identified. So, you know, it is quite a complicated mix. So we have all of these things we have to consider. And then you have to ask, where do they come from? Because the air out there is a mixture of different sources, from diesel vehicles, gasoline vehicles. Even if we got rid of all the exhaust emissions, we'd still have pollution coming from the brake wear, because when you brake, big plumes of copper are released into the atmosphere. We also have police suspension, very purpose. So it's a complicated picture. And then there are other things. Where's it coming from? Well, in London, you could really take a lot of that information and condense it down and say, there are lots of things here, but there is a sort of common theme, and that it's largely traffic-derived. In London, it's the traffic-derived pollution we're concerned about. And many of these things actually sort of vary together. So when NO2 goes up, you tend to see an increase in the particles in the air, you see an increase in the black carbon. It's traffic, and particularly, it's diesel traffic, diesel vehicles, and the preponderance and great density of diesel vehicles on our road. This is the elephant in the room. It's called exposure. Just because the air out there is polluted doesn't mean you're all exposed to it to the same extent. How much do you actually breathe? Depends on how much you ventilate. If you're running, you're going to breathe more than somebody who's walking quietly down the street. But the reason I've highlighted exposure here is, let's think of a group of individuals who spend more time outdoors than adults. Children. They have a greater exposure because they spend more time outdoors. They have higher ventilation rates. Their breathing rate's faster than an adult. So if they're outside, they breathe more of the air than you do. And they have smaller lungs, which are developing, which means the amount of toxins entering their lungs is greater per unit area of lung. So a child outside, if it's 70 micrograms per meter cubed, is getting a bigger dose of toxin than an adult in the same environment. It's one of the reasons why children are a sensitive subpopulation. How serious is it? Well, we're kind of fortunate in the sense that this has been reviewed by government. I don't have to go through. This is a report published in 2010 by the Committee on Medical Aspects of Air Pollution. This is the figure the government itself will quote to you about the magnitude of the air pollution problem. In fact, this is the figure they quoted in a very recent House of Lords debate, which was raised by Lord Wilson. In 2008, the UK population lost, 340,000 years of life. So don't think about this, about everybody in this room losing a proportion of their life in relation to the exposures. But you can think of it another way. You take that 340,000 and you think about the most sensitive individuals, it means there are 29,000 premature deaths in the United Kingdom per year arising from particulate pollution. That is a huge number. It's greater than the number of people dying of obesity-related illnesses. It's greater than the number of people dying of alcohol-related illnesses. It's only second to cigarette smoking within the United Kingdom as a cause of premature mortality. So this is a public health disaster which needs to be dealt with. And it's not just a disaster on a personal account. Economically, if you have a sort of vista which takes in the future and not just the next immediate four-year period of time, this is a huge burden on the health system. And we're meant to be protecting our investment in the health service by actually improving the public's health. This has to be one of our major targets. I've given you information about death because death statistics are very popular. But the problem when you look at death is that that's just the tip of the iceberg of health effects, okay? So if we have 29,000 premature deaths, that's going to represent a whole lot more, a whole massive increase in hospital admissions. There will be more people visiting doctors, asthmatics, people with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, people with cardiac disease, having to see their doctors, having to attend the GP surgeries. We're going to have increased medication use, so we have costs to the health service all the way down here. And then right at the bottom, in this sort of purple segment, is what's happening to everybody in the entire country just by being outside, near a road on a polluted day. Now, one of the things I do is I actually take happy Scandinavian medical students in place of Columbia, very far north in Sweden, and I put them inside chambers, and I expose them to diesel exhaust. At the concentration of diesel exhaust they would experience if they were in London. I can't do that study in London, because by the time you had arrived at my laboratories for me to expose you to diesel, you would have had more diesel than I'm about to give you as your challenge, okay? If I look at their lungs are inflamed, okay? Their lungs react to the diesel. You can see it has a physical effect on their airways. Another thing which I should make a point is we often get completely focused on boroughs. And lots of people in the rest of the world don't understand that, because most people don't live in cities in the world, don't live slap bang next to busy roads, okay? But we do, because of the nature of London. And I do a lot of work in Tower Hamlets and Hackney, and this is just to illustrate the number of postcodes within 100 metres of a major road. And that becomes important in the next slide. Let me just do this. This, I think, is the most important figure. You can take this away with you, this would be the most important thing. I've been studying children's respiratory health in Tower Hamlets and Hackney for the last 5 years. This year's going to be the last year we're doing our study. Each of those dots is an 8 to 9 year old child. Okay? If you're looking at this map and it's yellow, and this is a map from 2009, it means that child is living in an area with an annual level of nitrogen oxide over 40 micrograms per meter cubed. That means it's not a hotspot. It's not that one tube on that one corner. It's almost the entirety of Hackney and over 90% of the area of Tower Hamlets. In this slide, there's only one child who lived in an area where the air quality of NO2 was legal, and he was over here. So let's put a number on it. I did this off the top of my head, and I think I can do it again. Tower Hamlets, Hackney, combined population about 500,000. If I was to assume conservatively 75% of the people in those boroughs lived in a high pollution area, it would mean that about 375,000 people in those two boroughs live in an area of illegal air quality. Okay? In that brown cloud. And that is just an unacceptable reality at the present moment in time. Don't think of abstract numbers, think about people. People. It's what the people who live in these areas and people forget about that. I just wanted to say it's not a new problem if you think, oh, he's going on about diesels and you've been told diesels are good. We've known diesels are bad since 1956. The first reports were published in the BMJ saying diesels were bad for health a long, long time ago. It's not a new story, okay? It's been around for a very long time. And in my area, we are completely surprised that people endlessly say, well, we didn't know, because we've been telling you for years. And then finally, you don't have to take my word for it. This is just one report, it's a very important report. The HEI is a US-funded institution, half-funded by government, half-funded by industry, okay? It's meant to give completely independent, legally sound summaries of air pollution and health advice. And they published this report, again in 2010, which reviewed the evidence. I'll just give you this fine one, because this is something you can wave in front of people, and you can say, it's not just a few scientists, you know, who've got a vested interest in the next research grant. This has been thoroughly reviewed. There is no doubt that being exposed to high levels of air pollution causes premature mortality. It's one of the most robust, repeatable pieces of scientific evidence there has been in the last 25 years. There's no doubt that if children have asthma, it makes their asthma worse. No doubt. And we're allowing our children to grow up in a city with unacceptably high air pollution. And also, and increasingly, I now believe there's no doubt that children who grow up in polluted areas have stunted lung development. Their lungs don't develop properly. We're seeing that in our children in Tower Hamlets and Hackney. Their lungs at 8 and 9 are already smaller than they ought to be. And that's a burden they will carry with them for the rest of their life.
Statistics within your piece. And to